Welcome, everyone. My name is Jesse Hawthorne Ficks. This is MiDNiTES for Maniacs. And in fact, this is DAy2 of us celebrating the great Dutch filmmaker Paul Verhoeven. How many of you were here last night? Wonderful. Fuck all of you for not being here. Quite excited that so many of you are coming out here tonight. We're not just playing two films. In fact, we have a secret midnight film. So some of you, you're going to be here for 7.5 hours. And this is truly what MiDNiTES for Maniacs has been about. This is a 15th anniversary for the film series that I started back at the 4-Star Theater, celebrating underrated, overlooked, and dismissed movies. I can't think of a better filmmaker than Paul Verhoeven and Robo Cop to symbolize this idea. Can we give it up for Robo Cop here? Now, I know a lot of you have seen Robo Cop a lot. You have it on every format. Someone told me that they have a Hi8 tape of RoboCop. It was a VHS classic. For those of you that grew up on VHS tapes, you would have to spend $79.95 to get a videotape, and you would watch it until it died, and then you would open it up and you'd fix it with tape. And then from there, some of you, you've watched it on DVD, Laserdiscs. Who has it on Laserdisc? Criterion Laserdisc, no less. Very nice. And you're the cassette man, too, yep. Aren't you? Nice. Wait. And now we got Blu-ray. And what is so special about tonight is that, for the most part, every one of us has watched this movie incorrectly in the aspect ratio. When the film was released, it had the wrong aspect ratio. It was cutting off the top and the bottom. A lot of you you're quite serious about this. You go over to your friend's house, and they have their TVs all messed up. They just want to fill the screen, so everything's stretched. And you got to change the aspect ratio on there so that you can see the film in the way that it was intended. The cinematographer, Paul Verhoeven, also worked with the cinematographer. Does anyone know the cinematographer's name of RoboCop? Why is we should have a battle off here. Jan de Bont, can you give me a movie that Jan de Bont has directed?
Speed.
Beautiful, Speed. Now, those of you that didn't know that answer, right? You can feel the intensity of Paul Verhoeven fans. And I know that some of you were dragged here tonight by them, and I want to talk to you for a second. You don't have to like RoboCop. It doesn't matter what they think of this movie. You get to have your own experience with this film, even if they're staring at you the whole film, seeing if you're gonna laugh at the same jokes that they got, because, again, they've seen it a lot. That's not the point of this. In fact, MiDNiTES for Maniacs is here to try and reevaluate movies that we often watched, either dismiss them because we thought they were terrible, like the co-feature tonight, Showgirls. Or in RoboCop's case, you really do realize that it's one of the greatest modern science fiction films ever. I mean, there is truly no smarter science fiction film in the 1980s. And we can argue about that, because the movie is gonna play like it's a comic book. It's gonna play like it's stupid. And it's going to play in a satirical manner. And so I want every one of you in here, if you've seen it once, never, or 20 times, I want you to look for something new. I want you to listen to characters in the background. I want you to pay attention to TV commercials. I want you to listen to the news that's playing, as opposed to what we do in real life, is we zone it out and try and look for a pair of boobs somewhere. This is all going to be mixed up in Paul Verhoeven's world. The screenwriter of RoboCop, he also wrote a film that we are screening tomorrow, Starship Troopers. The two of you can't answer this. Who's the screenwriter of RoboCop? Ed Neumeier. Who said that? A very quiet man. Oh, okay, it's junk. That's fine. Now, Ed Neumeier is going to work in this genre of science fiction. I want you to tell me what you think of RoboCop after this, especially those of you who have never seen it. Please raise your hand. Who's never seen RoboCop? You are proud of this. Don't worry, no one's going to spit on you.
Only the remake.
Okay? And Paul Verhoeven has talked a lot about how each of these movies are being remade. Yes, Starship Troopers is being rebooted. And, you know, remember, everyone hated Starship Troopers when it came out. So if you're going to hate the new Starship Troopers before you've seen it, then you're acting just like the people they hate. This is what MiDNiTES4MANiACS wants to try and undo. Now, I put a couple of 35mm trailers together to try and get you into the mood of how much influence RoboCop had on the time period. There are so many movies that were inspired by this film. This in itself was inspired by what James Cameron movie?
Terminator.
Now, RoboCop had a couple of sequels. We could talk about those. But only after we watch RoboCop. And tonight, as I said, we got the real aspect ratio for RoboCop, as well as the director's cut. So some of us, we've never seen the director's cut. This movie is extremely violent. And it's going to be so violent that you might actually get turned off by it. Like, it might feel ridiculous. It might feel like it's too much. That's the point. That's the point. And I want to give you a word. I gave this to you last night, those of you who are here for Total Recall, is that we've got this idea of being anti-human. What is that word? A misanthrope. Misanthrope. Many of us in this room, we fucking hate human beings. We hate all human beings. And that's why we laugh hysterically when we watch humans getting blown away. Of course, when a little animal gets hurt, we hate human beings. And this is something that Paul Verhoeven has done consistently throughout his films. I want you to look for that in this movie without having to think the movie's stupid. In fact, this is quite an interesting concept. Lastly, RoboCop is not a science fiction film. It's a Western. And I want you to look for the Western details, the little nuances here. The Western was not very popular in the 1980s. There was one Western that was made in the 1980s. What was it?
Silverado.
Who's seen Silverado? That was the 90s, buddy. Who's seen Silverado? Okay? Who's seen RoboCop? Raise your hand. Paul Verhoeven and Ed Neumeier did something very interesting with this film. Now, I'm hoping that you're going to stick around and watch Showgirls, an NC-17 35mm print back from 1990, what year?
Five.
Nice. Who saw Showgirls when it first came out?
They wouldn't let me.
They wouldn't let you. You were too young. This is a very special night for Showgirls as well because it is a neo-sincere screening. This concept is we are not watching Showgirls because it is so bad that it's good. In fact, I think that Showgirls is one of the greatest films of the 1990s. I wish I could pay that guy to laugh everywhere I go in my life. I double dare you to stick around and watch Showgirls tonight in a neo-sincere way. Now, if you look on your ticket stub, we've got a giveaway. These pink ticket stubs are sort of in the tradition of when we used to have things. We didn't have to streamline it all onto our computer. Some of you, you're going to keep this ticket stub because tonight is very special. We're here in the oldest movie theater in San Francisco, the Roxie Theatre. Can you give it up for this place? And this ticket stub has a number on it. It also tells you some very interesting information. In that upper right-hand corner, I would love for... What number should get this? We've got a poster here. Spok Art Gallery has made 50 of the probably the most beautiful poster I've ever seen of RoboCop. Spok Art Gallery here is co-presenting our series, is also doing a Miyazaki Museum exhibit, as well as we have a couple of double features in February. I want to give this poster away to somebody. I want to give this poster away to number 71. Where are you? Hey, fucking clap for her, you jealous bastards. There you go. Oh, you gotta keep your ticket. Now, don't worry, I have a couple other prizes for some of you. This poster right here, this is a poster for Paul Verhoeven's newest film that just won 2 Golden Globes, L. Isn't that a cute poster? Hey, don't spoil anything. I'd like to give this away to number 99. Who's number 99?
I got it last night, but I
dropped
my ticket.
Uh-huh, I'm sure. Here we go. Very nice. So those of you that need to complete... Beautiful. You gotta roll that up. Let me give you a poster too. Those of you who need to complete your Paul Verhoeven experience, it's still playing over at the opera. Now lastly, what do I want to give you? Oh, I want to give you this. We played this last night, Basic Instinct, one of the great San Francisco films. This is Sharon Stone, and we have some Sharon Stone fans in the house. All right. How about number 14? You got number 14? You gotta come on up to get it. Your husband is more excited about this than... There you go. I should give you an ice pick then. You guys, if you could please turn off your cell phones. We got a lot to think about here with Robo Cop. It works on many levels, but most importantly, this is a rocking good time, and it means so much that you would come on out to support the Roxie, MiDNiTES for Maniacs. And my name is Jesse Hawthorne Ficks. Have a wonderful time. Let's give it up for Robo Cop. Now last night I talked a little bit about Total Recall special effects. And often we watch science fiction or sort of special effect based movies, they are dated. And we don't know which way to go with it. And every science fiction film perhaps is dated. The day Avatar came out, those special effects were dated. And that isn't a bad thing. And in fact, when you were watching Total Recall last night or RoboCop today, you got to see some pretty spectacular stuff, a lot of physical special effects, latex special effects, or in this case, stop animation special effects. And also with science fiction, you often deal with the future. And I can tell you for the past 25 years, or now we've walked into 30 years with RoboCop, there's an iPhone in that movie. But for 30 years, that was ridiculous. Audiences would laugh hysterically when this little thing, oh yeah, sure, I'm sure you could really track them like that. Or when, you know, he puts his thumb drive into the computer and you get pictures and movie footage, and when you have little computer screens that are inside your Google glasses. For 30 years, this movie people have laughed at, and it's always important to rewind back through that because we think we're smarter than these movies often. And Paul Verhoeven has had to deal with this his entire life. People thinking that somehow they're smarter than him. And this means a lot to me that so many of you are here tonight. I have waited 20 years to show a neo-sincere screening of Showgirls, and tonight is the fucking night. Now, this concept of neo-sincerity has slowly emerged over the past decade. This is 15 years of programming underrated and overlooked movies. A lot of you genuinely love RoboCop. You would say it's one of your favorite films. You wouldn't have to say that it's your guilty pleasure, that it's so bad, that it's good. You would wear it. You would own it. And I'm very proud of this past 20 years being a Bay Area native that Peaches Christ has helped people keep showgirls in people's minds. Because as soon as it was released, it was, well, before it was released, in fact, people hated it. Many of us are guilty of this constantly. We decide that a movie is bad because we watched a trailer, which wasn't even cut by the filmmaker. It was probably made by the studio. And then we will say in the theater, oh, I don't want to see that. Or we'll read an article, AKA we read the headline of an article, and that supposedly said the film was terrible or the worst film ever made. And so we don't go to it. So as Beaches has kept this film alive, something that has baffled me is that most of the fans of Showgirls, they think it sucks. And I can't totally connect with them then. In fact, some of you, you bring some people out to MiDNiTES for Maniacs and you're like, no, John Carpenter's They Live. Seriously, this movie is amazing. And your friend laughs at the film, not with it. It looks the same. Ultimately, I'm going to break up with you. You don't get it. And when you don't get it, it's personal. Now, Paul Verhoeven, he has a great sense of humor. In fact, when Showgirls won the worst film of the year from the Raspberry Awards, he was the very first filmmaker to actually attend the Raspberry Awards and accept the fucking statue. Now, that shows a lot of confidence, and I know a lot of you in this room, you're artists. You are hoping to somehow achieve something. I don't know what it is. Last night, I was saying Arnold Schwarzenegger, he's really good at delivering a one-liner. And many of us in this room, we're not good at fucking anything. So I don't know why you beat up on him out of your own insecurities. So what we're walking into is something that has never happened. Showgirls is screening tonight, first off, in a 35mm print that's NC-17, and can we give it up for Carl, our projectionist? But while that has happened, what hasn't happened before is people going into this film not thinking it's stupid. That in fact, the journey of our character, Nomi, N-O-M-I, that was a very purposefully chosen name. It's not ironic, it's not accidental, it's just Nomi, like, do you know me? That's purposeful. The screenwriter of this movie, Joe Esterhaus, can we give it up for this sleazebag? He truly does understand the seediest side of America. Those of you who are here for Basic Instinct. It's not a stupid film. It's a smart movie. It just might not align with the world that you're used to. Now, Nomi, her goal here, no spoilers, is to somehow succeed in a big city. And many of you in this room, you know exactly how hard that is. This just doesn't happen to be the exploration of San Francisco, it's Las Vegas. Secondly, I want to bring up this issue that Verhoeven did with Total Recall and Robo Cop. We're talking about working class men, working class jobs, and somehow they want to achieve something bigger than just being mediocre. That is in Showgirls, that is the heart of Showgirls. It's the biggest disappointment in someone's life when someone says, you're a poser. You're mediocre. I didn't even remember you. What's your name again? These are the core issues that somehow, because Paul Verhoeven has a wonderful sense of humor, he loves to play movies in a satirical manner, people overlook it. Now, David Cross, he sent his wishes today, the real David Cross, for this neo-sincere screening. And I know a lot of you, you have watched this movie so many times. Yeah. You have the dialogue memorized. Others who have never seen it, can you please raise your hand proudly right now? Look at this. Now that means you're going to ruin it for them. If you don't treat this film, treat this audience, and treat the oldest movie theater in San Francisco with some respect. You're in a church here, it's a movie theater, and I'm daring you to let Showgirls actually achieve what it was attempting to do back in 1995. I have a bad feeling that no movie theater has ever allowed it to be funny. Riff Trax recently played Starship Troopers, where they talk through the movie, right? Because they're funny. They're smarter than the film. Starship Troopers is playing tomorrow. Starship Troopers is already funny. Why do you need someone to make satirical jokes about something that is all satirical? This is what neo-sincere, in fact, might be. You have been so ironic your whole life that you don't even know what you think anymore. You just make fun of everything, always. And someone says, wait, do you actually like that? I don't know. You could play it both ways, because you've just been ironic your whole life. Neo-sincerity is, you could make fun of Showgirls if you wanted to. Peaches Christ, who I called to make sure I could do this screening, will be screening Showgirls for its 20th anniversary this next year. Hopefully with some serious guest stars. If you want to yell out really funny things, go to that fucking screening. You will be escorted out of this theater if you think we came to hear you. I want to hear Paul Verhoeven tonight. I want to hear Joe Esterhaus. And I will put myself out on the line. I teach film history here. I will say that Elizabeth Berkley's method acting performance is practicing what Elizabeth Berkley was trying to preach. This was her big break in Hollywood. This was the moment she might become a star. And you can feel her giving it her all. And I am terrified that many of us are so scared to be honest and to truly give it our all that we end up just being mediocre. Showgirls is not. Showgirls is one of the greatest films of the 1990s. You guys, thank you so much for coming out tonight. Now, as I said, the movie is quite funny. There are some amazing characters, dialogue. And I want to give you some treats. Get your ticket stubs out, please. We got Robo Cop, 30th anniversary. As we're dealing with right now, Showgirls, the 22nd anniversary. And some of you who are gonna somehow make it through this 2.5 hour movie, we've got a secret surprise midnight movie directed by Paul Verhoeven. You'll see on your ticket what film it is. It is a 35 millimeter print. It is in Dutch. It is subtitled. It is the rarest thing I can imagine. Maybe one of the best things to start 2017 off with. Can I get number 171 to come on up? Number 171. This is a memoir by Joe Esterhaus, Hollywood Animal. Okay. I hope that's not punishment. All right, how about number six? Number six, you still here? Number 31. You got number 31? Number 69. They fucking left. Number 111. Number 111, you're right here? Now you get to choose. Come on up. You get to choose between two outdated media items. One is a VHS tape of Jean-Claude Van Damme's Cyborg. You have a VHS player?
I got a
I know, because that Laserdisc guy has it, I know. Which that means you probably want the extremely rare, out of print, CD soundtrack of Showgirls. That Showgirls CD has been like a dollar for decades, and now all of a sudden, right? This cult following, some of you would really like to listen to this music. I would. Number 125. We got number 125? Let's go back down one, 124. We were so close, right?
Yeah, I do, but I already have the tape.
You already have Cyborg?
Yeah.
You know what you get instead? It's a free ticket to Spetters and Starship Troopers tomorrow, right there. Spetters is the film that Paul Verhoeven got kicked out of his homeland for. It's about teenagers running amok. It's 1980. It's a truly rare screening tomorrow. Starts at 5 p.m. Starship Troopers is at 7:30 p.m. Next Wednesday, I have a double bill of What's Up Doc, Peter Bogdanovich's, and Noises Off. These two films will be introduced by Peter Bogdanovich, who will be here.
Wow.
It's over at the Alamo Draft House. Please buy some advance tickets. All right, how about number 48? You know what you get? Cyborg on VHS, what are you talking about? You guys, please, if you could, turn your cell phones off. This is a big moment. I want you to pay attention to the cinematography here. It's masterful. He is going to do tricks. One of them is breaking the 180 degree line. It's not an accident. It's on purpose. Every single character in this movie matters. Their names matter. What they're talking about matters. If it seems weird, think about it. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. My name is Jesse Hawthorne Ficks. This is MiDNiTES4MANiACS. Alright, Die Hard fans, can we give it up for Showgirls for a moment? It was remarkable to feel the beats of that film without people needing to laugh at every single line. There's going to be people who will always do that with the movie because it's become part of their lives. But what I've always found curious is that if the movie is so ridiculous, then the gang rape scene, it doesn't fit. And when you talk to a lot of fans of the movie and when you see it at the Peaches screenings, people try to laugh and make jokes about the gang rape, and it doesn't work because, in fact, the tone of the movie is not accidental. And it was beautiful to hear the weight of that sequence and then the rest of the movie. It's building up towards something like that. So what we're doing tonight, come on in, you guys, all the way out there. It's fun to take over a movie theater that used to be a porn theater. It used to play pretty much every single kind of genre over these past 80 years. I find Showgirls to be a lot like a movie called Babyface, a pre-code movie that in fact was disgusting for many audiences in the 1930s. And it takes time for people to look back on it. In fact, Babyface was censored for over 70 years to be able to hear what the movie was trying to really talk about. Now, getting to see the fourth man tonight is extremely special. This is completely out of pocket. by myself. We're not supposed to be screening this movie. There's no copyright laws there here in the U.S. So please don't tell anyone that this is happening. But it's made for the type of maniac that many of you are. I know you come out consistently, a bunch of you, to these types of screenings. Those of you that can't come out, I know that you watch movies day and night. You wake up in the morning to try to explore not just a filmmaker, but maybe the history of film. You've got your whole lives to do it, and when a special experience like this happens, that's why I would go out of my way to try and play the fourth man. I've never seen this in 35mm in a movie theater, and what better weekend to do it. Now, as I said, the fourth man is sort of the basic instinct of the Netherlands, basic instinct of Paul Verhoeven before he came to the States, and I've always thought of Paul Verhoeven much like Fritz Lang, who worked in Germany making perhaps some of the most important films of his time and Germany's time. And when fascism started to kick into gear, he saw it and decided to leave his own country. And he came over to the United States, where he decided, or had to, start making genre films. Genre films have never been respected. I don't care how many Quentin Tarantinos there are. The new genre films will be laughed at until 20 or 38 later, years later. One of you, hopefully, will be able to sum up Paul Verhoeven's career in your new script or your new film, and then you'll win the Academy Award, not Paul Verhoeven. So to get to see this movie tonight, it is extremely surreal. It is an art film. This is how it was released in the United States, at least in 1983. Did anyone see this movie in the theater? We're all fourth men virgins. You have noticed, perhaps, this past couple of nights that Paul Verhoeven will use a lot of the similar actors. We saw in Total Recall, Robo Cop, and most definitely tomorrow in Starship Troopers. But tonight, for those of you that are going to come tomorrow for Spetters, you're going to get a handful of Dutch actors that he worked with consistently. I don't want to spoil anything about this movie. This weekend is a continuation of what hopefully 2017 can help you with. For Spike Lee's 60th birthday in March, we're going to have a Spike Lee weekend here at MiDNiTES for Maniacs, celebrating movies like Bamboozled, Malcolm X, Crooklyn. And I feel that Spike Lee is another filmmaker that just keeps making the movies he needs to make. And if people pay attention to them, or they understand them or not, it's not going to stop him. And hopefully that's the same kind of movie viewer you are going to be. It doesn't matter if people laugh at what you are enjoying or wasting your money on, because it isn't. And 15 years of doing this film series, I've been teaching now for 11 years. And it's only through watching movies after midnight that I feel like I have reached the type of excitement and enjoyment about movies. So it means a lot that you guys are all here. Can we give it up for Carl one more time, who's projecting? And he's a real maniac, right? He really does only watch movies in 35mm. And that type of passion is just beautiful to me. So. Couple trailers to get you into the mood here of the fourth man, and I look forward to hopefully seeing some of you tomorrow or next Wednesday for What's Up, Doc and Noises.